This is Gene, and I'm on the surface. And as I take man's last step from the surface, back home for some time to come, but we believe not too long into the future, I'd like to just let what I believe history will record, that America's challenge of today has forged man's destiny of tomorrow. And as we leave the moon and Taurus Littoral, we leave as we came, and God willing, as we shall return, with peace and in hope for all mankind.
With those words, humans left the moon for the last time. In fact, it was the last time that humans have left low Earth orbit. That was Apollo 17 in December of 1972. Space exploration is hard. It was hard when the goal was to walk on the moon. It's even harder now that the goal is to put footprints on Mars. Here's a typical picture of the night sky. The moon is pretty easy to find. It's relatively close to us. It's a journey of about 3 days. Can you find Mars? If you're looking at the bright spot in the lower right-hand corner, you've found Venus. Mars is actually here. It's a small speck in the night sky. It's a journey of about 6 months. It's a pretty difficult target to get to, especially when you want to send people there, but that's exactly what we're planning to do. There are many barriers in getting there, including technical, physiological, and political. But NASA has a plan for human exploration comprising the world's largest and most powerful rocket, the most capable human spacecraft, an upgraded launch facility, and a mission plan that culminates in a crewed journey to Mars. We will, for the first time since the end of Apollo, send people away from the relative safety of Earth to explore a foreign world. Apollo launched on the top of a Saturn V rocket, and the Saturn V remains the largest and most powerful rocket ever launched. The rocket that NASA is currently developing to launch the Orion spacecraft is referred to as the Space Launch System, or the SLS. To give you an idea of the size of these rockets, if you were to put the first SLS down on a football field, the bottom of the rocket would be in one end zone, and the top of the rocket would stretch someplace the Cleveland Browns often have trouble finding, the other end zone. The SLS is being developed through a block upgrade approach. The first SLS for Exploration Mission 1 is referred to as Block 1. The Block 1 rocket will be able to deliver more than double the payload of current launch vehicles to low Earth orbit. And it's this first rocket that will deliver an uncrewed Orion spacecraft around the moon and back again for Exploration Mission 1, which will be the furthest that we've ever tested a human-rated spacecraft. Rockets are typically staged to reduce weight as they burn fuel, and the SLS is no different. The core stage is the main body of the rocket and houses the fuel for its four main engines and the avionics for the rocket. The core stage will be the tallest rocket stage ever built. The interim cryogenic propulsion stage is the upper stage for the Block 1 rocket, and it will provide the thrust to lift Orion out of low Earth orbit onto its historic first journey to the moon. The solid rocket boosters are heritage technology from the space shuttle era with a little extra kick. These boosters are each taller than the size of the Statue of Liberty, and they will provide the majority of the thrust for the rocket at liftoff. Two full-scale tests of these boosters have already occurred, paving the way for the first flight. For the first crewed mission of the Orion spacecraft, NASA will upgrade the rocket to what is referred to as Block 1B. The primary difference between the Block 1 and Block 1B vehicles is the addition of the exploration upper stage. With this enhanced upper stage, the SLS will be able to deliver more than triple the payload of current launch vehicles to low Earth orbit. And it's with this enhanced upper stage that we will be able to carry not just people on the Orion spacecraft, but NASA is also planning a series of payloads that we will deliver to the area around the moon. These payloads make up what we're calling the Deep Space Gateway, a kind of mini space station around the moon that will be our jumping off point to go to Mars. The NASA Glenn Research Center is playing a critical role in all of this. We are tasked with managing and developing the structures at the top of the rocket, whether it's carrying crew or cargo off the planet. Earlier this year, we awarded a contract to Dynetics with their partners Ruag, Sistema, and local Cleveland companies in technologies to develop and build the Universal Stage Adapter, or the USA. Its primary function is to adapt the larger diameter of the SLS upper stage to the smaller diameter Orion spacecraft. It provides the structure to safely carry the Orion from ground to orbit. In addition to carrying the Orion, the USA will also house the payloads that make up the Deep Space Gateway. As you can imagine, a rocket of this size produces a lot of heat, noise, and vibration, and the USA will provide a reasonable environment for those payloads to survive their trip to orbit. In addition to the Universal Stage Adapter, which will be used on crewed missions of the SLS, the Glenn Research Center also leads the development of payload fairings, which will be used on planned cargo missions of the SLS. Fairings are used to house spacecraft when the crewed Orion capsule isn't riding on top. The SLS will allow us the opportunity to dream of large space telescopes and planetary explorers that wouldn't be possible on other launch vehicles. It could also cut the transit time to distant locations. It could cut the time to travel to the Jovian moon Europa from around 7.5 years to a little over 2.5 years. This reduction in time is important to both the robustness of the probes that have to survive the harsh environments of space and to the researchers who traditionally have long wait times from launching their science instruments to actually collecting science data. Let me transition a little bit to talk about how we plan to use the SLS and Orion to build the capability to go to Mars. Earlier, I touched on what we're calling the Deep Space Gateway. It will be a structure around the moon with power, propulsion, a docking capability, and a small place for the crew to live in. It will allow astronauts to begin building and testing the systems needed for critical missions to deep space destinations. In addition to activities around the moon, the Gateway can also be used as a jumping-off point to go to other destinations, like Mars. The Glenn Research Center is leading the development of the first element of the Deep Space Gateway, which will launch on Exploration Mission 2 and begin this exciting new chapter of deep space exploration. And all of the Gateway elements will launch underneath either a USA or a payload fairing let out of Glenn, so it's a very exciting time for spaceflight development at the center. I'd like to leave you with what I think is one of the most important impacts of the SLS and Orion. This is my son with Peggy Whitson at the Neutral Buoyancy Lab in Houston. My kids are lucky to be exposed to the work that we do every day. But each one of us here has the ability to inspire and educate future generations. No matter what you do and for whatever reason you're in attendance tonight, we all have the ability and the responsibility to inspire the imagination and creativity of young people in this country. Apollo 17, that last mission to the moon that I began this presentation with, gave us this iconic picture. It was a picture that showed everyone how beautiful and fragile our planet is. Apollo inspired a generation of entrepreneurs and inventors. I grew up in the space shuttle era, and that's what inspired me. Much like Apollo, the space shuttle and the space station have inspired kids from around the world to pursue science and technical careers, the SLS and Orion have the opportunity to do the same. This is a picture of people in Times Square watching the landing of the Curiosity rover. These are the faces of people inspired by the landing of a robot on Mars. A robot. Imagine what these faces will look like when we land people on Mars. NASA and the work that we do is inspiring, and I hope that our work will inspire my children and future generations around the world.